حس دوگانه ایه، خیلی احساسات متناقضی دارم. اولا که خیلی خوشحالم برای اینکه من هیچ وقت به اسکار فکر نکرده بودم، بودن تو رقابت های اسکار، برای اینکه خب همیشه
Well, it's bittersweet. It's at least twofold. And of course, there's lots of different feelings. So, on the one hand,
hello, hi, Mohammed.
hi.
Thank you. Thank you so much for your time. A pleasure to be talking to you.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Yes, and hello to the translator. I don't know your name, but thank you so
Hi.
Much for doing that.
Hi, Jana. Pleasure. My name's Jante.
Thank you so much for that. What an amazing movie. And you are a very courageous filmmaker, and I applaud you for that. Thank you so much for bringing that story to life. And was like shot in secret. Everybody knows that. But what was like, why you did that? Why you want to tell this story so much?
من همیشه داستان فیلمامو از نگاه کردن به اطرافم پیدا میکنم و سوالایی که درباره زندگی در محیطی که نفس میکشم منو درگیر خودش میکنه و فیلمسازی بر من یه جوری مرور این سوالاست، نگاه کردن به این سوالاست، گفتن این سوالاست. بنابراین خیلی برام مهم بود که مثل همیشه بتونم بدون اینکه جلوی سانسور زانو بزنم کارم رو انجام بدم.
So I always pick stories from my surroundings, from what is breathing and living around me. And of course, all the questions that this causes for me. So you could say that filmmaking for me is a way of reviewing the questions that animate me, of reflecting. And of course, also, I always wanted to tell the stories that I find important and the issues that I find important rather than kneel to censorship.
Yeah, so beautifully shot. And I was reading an article and then says that you not all the time you're on set with everybody else, with the actors and with the crew. What was the challenge to do a movie like that, that sometimes you're away from the set?
خب بله، خیلی سخت بود برای اینکه وقتی ارتباط از راه دور میشه یه دشواریایی برای بیان کردن خواسته ها به وجود میاد، ولی از طرفی هم یه تجربه متفاوتی بود برای من، برای اینکه دیگه رابطه‌ام با صحنه قطع شده بود و فقط داشتم مانیتور رو میدیدم و دیگه متوجه نبودم اون اطراف دقیقا داره چه اتفاقی میفته. بنابراین تمام تمرکزم روی مانیتور بود، از طریق دوتا دستیار که یکی با بخش فنی منو مرتبط میکرد و یکی با بخش هنری بازیگرا، میتونستم خواسته هامو با اونا در میون بذارم. آره خیلی سخت بود، دوست ندارم دیگه تکرار بشه، ولی به هر حال یه تجربه ای بود.
Of course, it was very difficult because everyone had to try harder because I could not exp because when because communicating my requests, my needs, my desires was much more difficult, not being there in person. At the same time, it was a unique experience per se, and since my relationship with the scene itself, with the set had been cut, and I only had this monitor, I wasn't really, I couldn't follow what was happening around the monitor, around the actual frame, if you see. Thanks to my two assistants on set, one of whom put me in touch with the camera department and that side of the work, the more technical side, if you like, and the other one who through whom I communicated with the actors and other departments, the more artistic ones, if you like. And so maybe that allowed me to focus more on the monitor. I had this fortune, if you like, because I couldn't follow what was happening around it. So it was certainly unique. It was very difficult. I'm glad I had this experience in a way, but I don't want to film again. I don't want to shoot that way anymore.
I bet it was a really big challenge there, and especially, but it was so, I don't know, there's something about it that is so well done, and you were able to get everything through the monitor with especially the actresses. They are
Was
such an amazing, like
as
the
that
mom and the daughters, and there's a chemistry there that is
and that
that
she
you were able to get it and through us. So amazing.
رسیدن به یه همچین فضایی باعث می شد که پر پروداکشن پیش تولید خیلی طولانی بشه، خصوصا انتخاب این آدم ها کنار هم دیگه یه پروسه طولانی بود واقعا.
Of course, working this way meant that we had to have a very extensive and very long pre-production process. And the most difficult thing, perhaps, was casting these roles, really placing these actors next to one another.
ما تمرین های زیادی داشتیم با همدیگه قبل از اینکه فیلم برداری شروع بشه، بیشتر شبیه مهمونی بود این تمرین ها، ولی زیاد راجع به فیلم نامه، نقش ها و کاری که باید جلو دوربین اتفاق بیفته حرف زدیم.
علت مهمونی رو بگم.
آره.
So of course we did many rehearsals, which we often had to disguise as parties, not to attract attention, during which we really discussed extensively the script, what should happen in front of the camera, the characters.
با این حال فکر میکنم مهمترین چیز خلاقیت و توانایی خود گروه بود، چه بازیگرا چه عوامل فنی، که این فاصله رو سعی میکردیم جبران کنیم با هم دیگه.
Nonetheless, I think the most important thing was the creativity and the skill of the entire cast and crew who tried it in every way to shorten this distance.
Yes, it's really beautiful. Also, how long have you been working in this movie, from the script, from not from when it was premiered in Cannes?
از موقع کار این فیلم از موقع نوشتاری فیلم نامه تا نمایش اول تو کن
خب، فیلم نامه خیلی زودتر تو ذهن من یه چیزایی شکل گرفته بود، ولی از لحظه‌ای که شروع کردم به نوشتن فکر میکنم 4 ماه طول کشید تا همه چیز روی کاغذ اومد.
So writing the script itself from the moment I took the pen in hand took about 4 months, but of course I'd been writing a lot of things in my head for a long time before.
و شکل و اجرا و فیلمبرداری و پست پروداکشن هم 5 ماه طول کشید و تقریبا میشه گفت 9 ماه.
Pre-production, huh? Whereas pre-production to shoot to post-production took about 5 months, so we're talking of about 9 months altogether.
تقریبا اندازه یه بچه آدم چجوری به دنیا میاد.
Just like a fetus, how long it takes a baby to be born.
Yes, exactly. I was about to say that. So, and in this whole process, I know it was really challenging, and then you were able to get asylum in Germany, and now you'll be like the German selection for best international picture. How do you feel about that?
خیلی حس دوگانه ایه، خیلی احساسات متناقضی دارم. اولا که خیلی خوشحالم برای اینکه من هیچ وقت به اسکار فکر نکرده بودم بودن تو رقابت های اسکار، برای اینکه خب همیشه حکومت توی ایران که فیلم ها رو برای معرفی به اسکار انتخاب میکنه، و من از اول فعالیتم همیشه درگیر بودم با سانسور و حکومت، بنابراین همیشه این قسمت از ذهن من خاموش بود.
به صورت ما میتونیم بگیم ملس
مم.
خوبه برای دوگانه.
مم.
Well, it's bittersweet. It's at least twofold. And of course, there's lots of different feelings. So, on the one hand, I had actually never thought that my film, any of my films, would be submitted for the Academy Awards because of the way I make my films, they defy Iranian censorship. And obviously, you need your country to submit your film for the Academy Awards. So, it was clear that the Islamic Republic would never, ever submit my film for the Academy Awards.
و از طرفی وقتی که این انتخاب اتفاق افتاد و من مطلع شدم به خودم احساس کردم چقدر جهان میتونه جای جالبی باشه وقتی که در یک کشور دیگه آغوششون برای فرهنگ و فرهنگ انسانی و رنجای مردم در سراسر دنیا چقدر این آغوش بازه و من فکر میکنم این خیلی یه فرصت استثناییه که یه نشانه هست برای فیلم سازایی که در همه جای دنیا ممکنه با شرایط من کار میکنن و شاید یه نور و امیدی است برای اینکه اونا استقلال خودشون رو حفظ کنن.
And yet, I think it's exceptional to be. So, when this happened, when I understood that Germany had done this, I was profoundly moved by the warm embrace that Germany showed towards me and my pain and the pain of my country. And I think it's an exceptional opportunity that another country can do such a gesture. And it is a sign towards all the filmmakers all around the world who are working in similar circumstances to mine.
گاهی اوقات فکر میکنم که سینمای آلمان تصمیم گرفت پیام مردم ایران رو نمایندگی کنه.
At times I think that German cinema decided to represent the message of the people of my country.
Is amazing. I salute them as well. So it's amazing. Also, there is this footage from the social media, like there are kind of archival footage, and it was very powerful when you mix in throughout the movie. How was like that? Like to get those images and because you don't see that on the news, right? And it's, that happened to my country as well. I'm from Brazil, and we have some issues as well. And sometimes they don't show the real images on the news, and then we see on social media. So how is it for you to get those images, those videos? And was difficult? Was easy? How was that process?
خب همطور که گفتن این سرکوب و اختناق تو بخش روزنامه نگاری توی ایران هم وجود داره و روزنامه نگارا هیچ وقت نمیتونن در صحنه حضور پیدا کنن و این تصاویر رو ثبت و برای دنیا ارسال کنن.
اختناق یعنی
سرکوب.
Yes, just as you mentioned, we do have this level of repression in the media in Iran whereby journalists are never allowed to be present, in fact, on the scene, to document it and to relay it to the rest of the world.
در جهان امروز و با تکنولوژی های خیره کننده ای که الان وجود داره، خود معترضین نقش خبرنگارا و روزنامه نگارا رو هم بازی میکنن، این لحظات رو ثبت میکنن و به صورت ناشناس تو شبکه های اجتماعی در دسترس بقیه قرار میدن.
But today, thanks to the amazing advances of technology, protesters themselves take on the role of journalists, photojournalists, video journalists, recording themselves the events and then uploading them and circulating them anonymously on social media.
بنابراین من که داشتم یه فیلم زیرزمینی می ساختم و این امکان رو نداشتم که این صحنه ها رو بازسازی کنم یا اصلا بهش فکر کنم، از خودم پرسیدم که چطوره که برای اینکه نشون بدم بیرون این خونه یا این خانواده داره چه اتفاقی میفته از صحنه‌های واقعی استفاده کنم.
And then of course here I am making this film underground in secret about a family that has become trapped in its own apartment, and so I need to find a way to show what's happening out on the streets, and that's where these videos come in.
اینطوری هم میتونستم نشون بدم که شبکه‌های اجتماعی دارن چه نقشی بازی میکنن، هم اون دخترای جوون فوق‌العاده شجاع، پسرای جوون فوق‌العاده، و هم شدت سرکوب و وحشیگری رژیم تو همه چیز اون تو هست واقعا.
And then, of course, this allowed me to illuminate some other aspects inside the film. For instance, the importance of social media for these protests, especially, but also this exceptional young generation, these extraordinary young men and young women and young men, but also the level of violence and savagery of the regime, of the repression.
Yeah, they are very courageous, just like you, just like you. So, yeah. So for us to wrap it up, I want to congratulate you again, and I want to ask you, what do you think the audiences are gonna take away from your movie? Because now everybody's gonna be able to watch it, especially here in North America and the whole world. What do you think people you expect from the audiences this time around?
من فکر میکنم یک داستان خانوادگی هست که نشون میده که اختلاف نسل ها، تفاوت بین نسل ها داره چجوری پیش میره. منازعه سنت و مدرنیته رو میبینیم و در این حال هرچی داستان جلو میره با یک لایه های جدیدی روبرو میشه مخاطب که میتونه تصویر مهمتر از یا تصمیم تعمیم یافته ای از یک خانواده به یه جامعه رو پیدا کنه، و شاید این قسمتش هم لذت خودش رو داره که چجوری میشه این داستان رو بزرگتر دید،
تعمیم یافته Okay. So I think it's primarily a story of a family that shows the struggle between different generations, that also shows the struggle between tradition and modernity in Iran. And as the story progresses, it accrues more and more levels. And I think it might be pleasurable for the audience to note how this family really comes to symbolize a much wider society and even more than that.
برای من خیلی جالبه اگه بتونم تصور کنم که لایه‌های روانشناختی که تو این داستان برای من مهم بوده در ذهن مخاطب هم شکل بگیره.
I would love it if the psychological aspects of the story that were so important for me could also be perceived by audience members.
Amazing. Mohammed, I forgot your name. I'm sorry. I just want to thank you so much for your time. A pleasure to meet you both. And the movie is amazing. I love it. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
If you like to support or continue to support Jana on Camera, don't forget to subscribe, like, comment, and share the videos.